Shalom, Chavrim. I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live. Troubling situation, of course, in North Korea. And very interesting situation also after the G20 summit meeting there. Let's go to North Korea first. So I wanted to share some interesting things there with you. Of course, keeping in mind the biblical prophecy of Daniel 11, this speaks about tidings out of the east and north. Trouble him. Troubles who? Troubles the king of the north, that is. And that king of the north, I believe, is a Roman king that is governing the U.S. and British forces, or we could say the NATO forces there, that is warring throughout the Middle East. And even, of course, now we're seeing that there is some trouble that he's run into. Because why? Prophecies are not going to be fulfilled the way he would like to manufacture them if he gets distracted with North Korea. And that trouble, or the tidings out of the east and out of the north, happens to do with China and Russia and their willingness to protect Kim Jong-un in the event of an unlikely war in that region. Says here, North Korea on the Independent warns U.S. and South Korea military drills are pushing region to a tipping point of nuclear war. And that's after Kim Jong-un, of course, launched recently this ICBM that does have the capability of hitting U.S. territory without any question, and of course the U.S. and South Korea responded using live drills with the supersonic B-1 bombers and other aircraft near North Korea's borders there, which has really kind of irritated North Korea. But of course, North Korea, what can you expect? They are kind of bringing it upon themselves by continuing testing these missiles. But here's the problem. Here's where the tidings come. This is where the problem is. As it states in this article right here on ropedrop.net, experts surprised by Chinese and Russian coordination on North Korean policy. Very thing that's interesting in this article happens to be the last part. It does say, I can't understand why anyone is surprised by the synchronization of China and Russia, North Korea strategy. China and Russia have long had the common goal of weakening the United States' commitment to alliances in Northeast Asia. But watch the last part of the article right here. It says here, but some regional policy experts fear that a united Sino-Russian front on North Korea could make it more difficult for the U.S. to rein in Pyongyang's burgeoning nuclear program. The fact that Moscow and Beijing are using virtually identical language and are very united at this time, I think, will provide great comfort to Kim Jong-un, said David Pressman, a former U.S. ambassador to the United Nations for political affairs, who now works at the Boies Schiller Flexner law firm. So yes, China and Russia, they still seem to be very much working there with North Korea's Kim Jong-un. And then, of course, Nikki Haley, she comes out and CNN covers this, but we're actually looking at Breitbart News on this. If China does not stop North Korea, we will start looking at trade relations with China. Seems like that the United States is backing off from the rhetoric of using force and even possibly nuclear force to stop North Korea. Why? Because it is a threat that China and Russia would go to war with the United States, and something that President Trump does not want to happen, especially after the G20 summit there, meeting with President Vladimir Putin, that has been regarded by many analysts already, including that of Secretary of State Rex Tillerson and Foreign Minister Lavrov, said that they really kind of hit it off together. They had really working good together. In fact, President Putin said about President Trump that he was much different in person than he is on television, said that he was very businesslike, someone that he could work with. But you know, not everybody seems to like their relationship. And I, for one, did question this whole idea of the ceasefire in southwest Syria, because in my opinion, the ceasefire has really, it's not to say a ceasefire is not a good thing, but why only southwest Syria? Isn't it a little bit odd that where the United States wants a ceasefire with is the very places where the Syrian president, Bashar al-Assad, was gaining headway against ISIS and al-Qaeda. Al-Qaeda on Israel's border, close to the Golan at Quneitra, which is literally meters away from Israel's border, and as well as Dada and al-Suwaid, Dada, where the Syrian government has been really hammering ISIS since they took over this little village there close to the Jordanian border. But of course, right across that border there, we have U.S. forces and British forces with a huge base not far inside the Jordanian territory there that is a threat for U.S. Strategic moves there. But at the same time, the U.S. is, I was bringing out the other day, the U.S. is actually has a new 300 long meter air base that they have built right near Al-Tanf. Oddly enough, with about five other mini bases all around this airfield there for protection. This 304 meter long airfield, according to our good friend Lorenzo at alreadyhappened.com, has also pointed out the fact that the F-35A can take off in 200 meters. Doesn't even need the full 304, but could take off and land in that short of a space. And on top of that, we're also looking at the fact that the F-35B, well, it can just take straight off like a helicopter. Doesn't even need the actual runway. Some have argued that that airfield that was built there was actually done so for the sake of helicopters. Well, helicopters don't need 304 meter long airfield to take off in. And the U.S. is the one that has actually constructed this inside of Syrian territory against President Bashar al-Assad's wishes, no doubt. So the whole thing is what's going on? Of course, President Trump, President Putin said this has been going on for months now. They've been working this in the background. But why is this sudden ceasefire? Well, I have a feeling that Rome is running into a little bit of a problem and getting prophecy to fulfill exactly the way they would like it to do. So they have to kind of buy more time. Stall the taking down of Damascus. But don't fear, friends. They will take it down. All they're doing is giving their particular supported allies on the ground, Al-Qaeda and ISIS, a chance to rearm and regroup because the Syrian president was doing a pretty good job at taking them down. Now, why did President Putin why is he willing to do this? Well, at first I kind of wondered, is he not playing ball with the New World Order? Is that what he might be doing? Maybe not. And I say maybe not because he did a little something a little bit odd just recently, and that was he took a different flight route going into the G20 summit. And this is reported on Sputnik News. It says, here's why Putin's plane skirted NATO's eastern flank on approach to the G20 summit, completely would not go over Belarus or Poland, mainly because of Poland. He went through non-NATO member states. Well, as you can see out his window, there are all these ships that are there on the Baltic Sea, but that could be Russian ships for all we know there as well. But according to Mr. Peskov, the spokesman for President Putin there, he actually said that the reason is not to be disclosed because of the security concerns for the president. But he went 500 kilometers out of his way to make sure he got to Germany safely. That lets us know that anywhere near Poland or Lithuania or Latvia, any of these other areas there that are NATO allies there, he's concerned that he could get shot down. Letting us know that President Putin doesn't fully trust NATO partners, even though he may have some trust with President Donald Trump. Well, he has good reason. As is also pointed out in the article here, those of you that may remember, not long ago, the Polish military F-16 flew dangerously close to Foreign Minister Lavrov's plane there, and that was with Russian escort Sukhoi fighters as well. They had to chase the guy off. So if the president's flying over, I'm sure President Putin's concerned about becoming a target. So it kind of makes you wonder, why did President Putin then be willing to do a ceasefire in Syria? Unless he's trying to buy time as well. Naturally, because President Putin doesn't want to go to a war with NATO. That is one huge beast. And he knows that the only avenue at that point is nuclear and not conventional. Because Russia would have too much on their hands in a conventional war with NATO's all these countries against one country, or at best with Iran and what is left of the Syrian military fighting as well. So that's where the trouble comes in. But now, they met at the G20. President Putin, President Trump hit it off pretty good. President Trump questions directly President Putin, kind of like the old-fashioned way of dealing with things. Did you do it or not? Face to face, President Putin says, no, I did not. Well, President Trump took him at his word. So they begin to try to build on something, try to build a more trusting relationship. Well, that kind of went south as well. Why? Because now President Trump and President Putin are discussing forming a cybersecurity unit to fight electioning hacking. Nobody seems to like that idea in Washington either. In fact, if anything, they're making fun of him for doing so. Let me give you a little bit of ideas of what's going on here at Face the Nation. Here is John McCain and what he had to say about it.
Said Putin and I discussed forming an impenetrable cybersecurity unit, so that election hacking and many other negative things will be guarded. What do you
think? I am sure that Vladimir Putin could be of enormous assistance in that effort since he's doing the hacking. I mean, it's...
As you can see, John McCain kind of finds it very humorous, and it was no different than what we've seen with also with Senator Lindsey Graham. Senator Lindsey Graham says... speaks about it as being one of the most ridiculous things that he has ever saw. So again, it is kind of a little bit awkward to talk about working together on security, cyber hacking, etc., especially when you've already accused Russia of doing so. And as I've stated before, I do believe that President Trump may very well have good intentions, but the deep state definitely has him in his pocket. Or is President Trump just playing President Putin? After all, he is very close to the Vatican. And the Vatican definitely is the one that is calling the shots on what's going on in the Middle East. We just have to sit back, watch how things play out, and see how it goes. But clearly, tidings out of the East and out of the North are troubling him. I'm Stephen Benoon. You're watching Israeli News Live. Erev Tov.